Talk about decision making in all of this, how that can be measured, and to catch a fly ball, I reference that at the top. Just the amazing computations that go into something like that.
It might help as a simplifying metaphor for some of the challenges that we have, at least this theme that I'm pushing, that we need some way to deal with this complexity. Take the task of catching a fly ball, yes? So one idea is to, Dawkins has, and other psychologists have forwarded this idea, and the idea is basically the player calculates the trajectory of the ball. So it's going to know where the ball goes and then runs to catch it. So this is Dawkins. When a man throws a ball high in the air and catches it again, he behaves as if he'd solved a set of differential equations, predicting the trajectory of the ball. At some subconscious level, something functionally equivalent to the mathematical calculation is going on. So this line of thought is embracing the complexity of this problem. What are we doing? We're doing calculus, we just don't know it. So what else could it be? Well, there's another option. Hold on a minute before giving this slide, because I want to just describe it simply. So the first is to say that we're doing mathematics, even subconsciously, and solving differential equations to catch a ball. That's what all baseball players are doing. The other is something called the gaze heuristic. So this is the nice idea here is that it simplifies the task, behaves completely different than what I've just described. In fact, the cues that it uses, not a single variable that I wanted them to put up actually the differential equations to show you, but they wouldn't do it. But you have to imagine it. If you haven't calculated a trajectory, you should take a look. It's a little nasty. None of the terms that you would have in the equation are used in the next rule that I'm going to give you, and it happens to turn out that this is what players actually use that are measured. They can't describe it, but they nevertheless follow this pattern. It's three rules, and this one works actually when the ball is already aloft. First, fix your gaze on the ball. Two, start running. Three, adjust your speed so that the gaze of the ball, your angle of gaze, stays constant. And if you do this, you'll meet the ball. If you play frisbee with a dog, you'll notice that they're not doing calculus often enough. You throw the frisbee, they're not running after it, they're running alongside of it so they can catch the gaze and then jump and catch the ball. You see this with fish, you see this with other animals trying to catch prey or a mate, this can be similar. The idea here is this thing can be used deliberately. This is an intuitive rule. And it's something that was used recently for an event here, this miracle on the Hudson, right? You remember this is the plane that took off from LaGuardia, lost both of its engines, and the decision needed to be made quickly whether to return to LaGuardia to land or do something more risky, like land in the Hudson. And basically, it was a version of this gaze heuristic. The co-pilot, Jeffrey Skillies, spotted in the windshield the control tower back at LaGuardia and noticed that the tower was moving ever so slightly up in the windshield, which that is the angle the gaze was changing. And the direction of the change was such that they wouldn't make it. So the decision was made. Well, you know what happened. And this is, in interviewed afterwards, this is exactly what Skillies said. So it's not so much a mathematical calculation as visual, in that when you fly an airplane, a point that you can't reach will actually rise your windshield, a point that you are going to overfly will descend in the windshield. Now, why do I raise these examples? There are beautiful, that I study, I love mathematical theories for decision making, for example. And they're very similar to the Dawkins approach about how one ought to reason. Norms of reason follow from these things. And then you look to see how people are actually doing this, and it doesn't resemble it at all. So there's this question of, how do you bridge this gap? And what we're hearing on the panel tonight are clues that I, as a theoretician, find tantalizing. So for instance, I'm learning what, forgetting, for instance, wiping out information is crucial to us. We're bombarded with information, so we have mechanisms to wipe out things so we can focus on the bits that are most salient, that are most relevant to us making a good, sound decision. And likewise, these simple rules that I just mentioned before are exploiting both cognitive capacities that we have and also the interaction that we have with the environment.
I see myself becoming a different person every once in a while. And certainly, you know, when I look back on who I was in my 20s, I think of being a different person.
So let me ask you this, and I agree with you.